بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We return to the path of worshippers, to the paradise of the Lord of the Worlds. منهاج العابدين إلى جنة رب العالمين. And inshallah, we will read today chapter 1, the obstacle of knowledge. قال إمام الغزالي رحمه الله وهي عقبة العلم، العقبة الأولى وهي عقبة العلم. And we have already mentioned, but I will continue to do so, that the translation of Aqaba as valley is not really, does not capture the notion of Aqaba. Aqaba is an obstacle. It's just like you could run the 100 meters as a competition or on your own, without any hurdles, without any barriers, or there are barriers. This life cannot be without barriers. And when Imam Ghazali said, عَقَبَةُ الْعِلْمِ, obviously, it's not any knowledge. عَقَبَةُ الْعِلْمِ, it is knowledge about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, knowledge of the religion that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to humanity until the day of judgment, to understand Islam, to understand revelation, to understand the Quran, and also to understand the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is not against knowledge of the sciences, the exact sciences of the humanities. This is not against art, but really, ultimately, the issue is you need knowledge. You need knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you gain knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you'll understand your purpose in this life. Once you understand your purpose in this life, you understand that intention is the foundation of any accepted action, then you need to act upon that. Then you could, as an act of devotion, let's say, you could basically write in beautiful Arabic calligraphy something from the Quran. You express the love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the love for His Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You could also ponder upon the universe, not only as meditation, as a lay person, if you will, but also as a scientist, as an astrophysicist, as a physicist, as a biologist. You look into all these living organisms, as a chemist, but always it's basically the path of knowledge that leads to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then you'd understand almost everything else, because we are not capable of understanding every single thing except that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permitted us to do so. وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءَ. That humanity, in its every single human being, cumulative knowledge, from Adam alayhi salam until the very last person on earth, this knowledge is definitely partial knowledge. And of course, human beings are capable of creating false knowledge. And knowledge could be knowledge as ilm. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-alim. But we don't attribute ma'rifa. Most Muslim scholars would not attribute ma'rifa to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because ma'rifa, this knowledge that is acquired knowledge for us, it's always after ignorance, after not knowing, and this cannot be attributed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Imam al-Ghazali said, فأقول وبالله التوفيق يا طالب الخلاص والعبادة عليك أولا وفقك الله بالعلم فإنه القطب عليه المدار. So the first obstacle is that of knowledge or seeker of salvation and worship. With the help of God, I say that it is your duty to acquire knowledge. Knowledge is like a pole around which everything revolves. And of course, the image of the pole, it's just like the pole of a tent. The tent is basically dependent on a pole, the central pole in the middle. If it collapses, then everything collapses, the whole tent collapses. وعلم أن العباد أن العلم والعباد جوهران لأجلهما كان كل ما ترى وتسمع من تصنيف المصنفين وتعليم المعلمين ووعظ الواعظين ونظر الناظرين، بل لأجلهما أنزلت الكتب وأرسلت الرسل، بل لأجلهما خلقت السماوات والأرض وما فيهما من الخلق. فتأمل آيتين في كتاب الله عز وجل، إحداهما قوله تعالى: الله الذي خلق سبع سماوات ومن الأرض مثلهن يتنزل الأمر بينهن لتعلموا أن الله على كل شيء قدير وأن الله قد أحاط بكل شيء علما. وكفى بهذه الآية دليلا على شرف العلم، لا سيما علم التوحيد. So before basically we continue to the second verse, let's read what Imam al-Ghazali has to say thus far. Know that knowledge and faith are two essences upon which everything is based. What you see or hear in the writings of authors, the teachings of teachers, and the advice and guidance of preachers. Indeed, God, majestic and glorious is He, sent down all messengers and scriptures for the sake of faith and knowledge. Heaven, earth inhabitants, and all creatures that reside in between them were created for the sake of knowledge and faith. And of course, worship. Reflect on these two verses, as God says, it is God who created seven heavens and of earth their like, between them the command descending, that you may know that God is powerful over everything and that God encompasses everything in knowledge. There is a phrase that is missing really from the English. Imam al-Ghazali says after this verse, suffice it with this particular verse, enough proof how honorable knowledge is. Knowledge is honorable. Seeking knowledge is honorable. He says, لَا سِيَّمَ عِلْمِ التَّوْحِيدِ, especially knowledge of the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But he does say that the first verse is sufficient indicator of the nobility of knowledge, especially the science of God's unity, tawheed really. Just as the second verse is sufficient indicator, So he postponed basically mentioning this until after the second verse, which is وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I guess as a translator who he basically gave himself the liberty to postpone that particular phrase. وَكَفَى بِهَذِهَا دَلِيلًا عَشَرَ فِي الْعِبَادِ وَزُومِ الْإِقْبَالِ عَلَيْهَا. Then again, I would say it's just as the second verse is a sufficient indicator of the novelty and the necessity of worship. So knowledge and tawheed. And then شرف العبادة. فأعظم بأمرين هما المقصود من خلق الدارين فحق للعبد ألا يشتغل إلا بهما ولا يتعب إلا لهما ولا ينظر إلا فيهما. فاعلم أن ما سواهما من الأمور باطل لا خير فيه ولغو لا حاصل له. Glorified are those two matters for those for whose sake the two worlds were created. As such, it becomes as the slave's right to become exclusively preoccupied with these two matters, exerting effort for nothing and contemplating nothing outside the realm. Know that any other affair is false and worthless. I hope that we will use other writings of Imam al-Ghazali to explain that there are certain things. If every single person seeks knowledge, stops working, what will happen to life? I will answer this after I entertain something that Imam Sha'rawi, the contemporary Egyptian, he passed away many years ago, but he lived in the 20th century. And mashallah, his interpretation of the Quran is widely distributed and accepted. He said, if everyone on earth becomes a physician, life on earth collapses. And the same thing applies to seeking knowledge. But meaning, not everyone seeking knowledge, because everyone has to seek knowledge. But it means they seek knowledge and they don't do anything else. In this case, then it cannot be the life will collapse. Who's going to till the land? Who's going to cultivate? And who's going to harvest? And who's going to put that loaf of bread on the table? Of course, rizq sustenance is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But you need everything. We need basically housing. We need agriculture. We need clothing, so industry is also part of it. We need so many things. Now, if you ask me whether I would read Harry Potter, I would not. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Also, we have to understand that you could turn every halal activity into ibadah. Every halal activity into ibadah. So have the right intention. So someone is basically taking pictures of Al-Aqsa Mosque out of love. and he shares these pictures with the whole world, and he adds information about Al-Aqsa Mosque, the history, the theology, the caretakers, the custodians of the holy places in Jerusalem. So inshallah, with the right intention, this inshallah will be accepted. I know of a lady, a Hindu lady, who accepted Islam. Subhanallah, she learned Arabic. And she is an artist, and she incorporated the verses of the Quran into her own works of art, into her own paintings. This is beautiful. Inshallah, this will be an act of worship. And I remember one of her paintings saying, this is the what Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam said in the Quran, Rabbi inni lima anzaltu ilayya min khayrin faqir. So Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, after he ran away from the Faruh and he arrived in Midian, a political, he sought political asylum in a sense, not in a formal way, the way we, but he was basically on his own, without money, without food, without family, without shelter, without job, without. He asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to provide him. He admitted, he humbled himself before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he said to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I am in need. Faqir. Faqir is poor, but here he said that, of course he is poor. He said, I am in need of your sustenance, of whatever you send my way, by way of sustaining me. By the evening, he had a wife, a job, a shelter, a house, also a father-in-law. Security. Subhanallah, he resorted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that painting would capture this such an act. إِذَنْ وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ لِيَعْبُدُونَ لِيَعْبُدُونَ covers every halal action done with the right intention. بإذن الله عز وجل. فإذا علمت ذلك فاعلم أن العلم أشرف الجوهرين وأفضلهما. ولذلك قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إن فضل العالم على العابد كفضل على أدنى رجل من أمتي. Now that this is clear, once you know the literal meaning, really, فإذا علمت ذلك. Once you know this, all the above, know that of these two treasures, knowledge and worship, the first is nobler, more honorable, because the master of the two engendered worlds, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, peace be upon him, verily the superiority of a scholar of religious sciences over a worshipper is like my superiority over the lowest ranking of my companions. Now this hadith, definitely the scholar is preferable to the worshipper. The hadith itself, the isnad, the chain of narrators, is not that strong, but the meaning is definitely correct, that the scholar is preferable to the worshipper. Why? Because the worshipper benefits himself and the scholar benefits people at large. His scholarship could travel in the old days a bit slow, but it will travel to every corner of the earth. And today, with the touch of a button, your knowledge, inshallah, will reach very, very far, and it will be available online. Look at the Quranic Thought website and look at all these treasures of the Islamic civilization, all these books, all this scholarship. All that we need is to roll up our sleeves and study and revive the knowledge that that is in these books. And another hadith, it's also it's not a sound chain of narrators. It does speak about looking at the you know, the a scholar, looking at the face of a scholar, it has weakness. But you know, to look at the face of scholars, or to look at the face of scantily dressed actresses on TV or cinema or whatever, on YouTube, or, and it could be worse than this. It's incomparable, but I just want to send, yes, why not be in the company of people? If you see a scholar, he will remind you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you see an actress, you might say la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. But definitely, it's not a direct reminder of knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of knowledge on the for the path, about the path of the hereafter. So this to call upon a scholar is dearer before me than praying, fasting, night and night vigil of a year. This is not really a sound hadith. Also, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam here, it said, again, it's a weak chain of narrators. أَلَا أَدُلُّكُمْ عَلَى أَشْرَفِ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ قَالُوا بَلَى رَسُولَ اللَّهِ قَالْ هُمْ عُلَمَاءُ أُمَّتِي. Do you wish that I show you the noblest inhabitants of paradise? They said, yes, O Messenger of God. He said, they are the scholars of my community. Definitely the scholars of the Ummah, and we speak about scholars, ulama rabbaniyin, not those whom Imam al-Ghazali criticized time and again, those who are seeking to gain only material gains through this knowledge. Definitely they are, inshallah, in high status, but the chain of narrators again is problematic. Now, reflecting on this Imam al-Ghazali, reflecting on these verses and traditions, he said, فَبَانَ لَكَ أَنَّ الْعِلْمَ أَشْرَفُ جَوْهَرًا مِنَ الْعِبَادَةِ وَلَكِنْ لَابُدَّ الْعَبْدِ مِنَ الْعِبَادَةِ مَعَ الْعِلْمِ وَإِلَّا كَانَ عِلْمُ هَبَاءً مَنْثُورًا فَإِنَّ الْعِلْمَ بِمَنْزِلَةِ الشَّجَرَةِ وَالْعِبَادَةِ بِمَنْزِلَةِ الثَّمَرَةِ مِنْ ثَمَرَاتِهَا فَالشَّرَفُ لِلشَّجَرَةِ إِذْ هِيَ الْأَصْلُ لَكِنَّ الْإِنْتِفَاعَ بِثَمَرَتِهَا فَإِذًا لَابُدَّ لِلْعَبْدِ مِنَ الْعِبَادَةِ لِيَسْلَمَ لَهُ شَرَفُ الْعِلْمِ ولابد أن يكون له من كل الأمرين حظ ونصيب. ولهذا قال حسن البصري رحمه الله, اطلبوا العلم, اطلبوا هذا العلم طلبا لا يضر بالعبادة, واطلبوا هذه العبادة طلبا لا يضر بالعلم. Therefore it becomes clear that of these two, knowledge and prayer, the former is nobler than the latter, but a perfect servant of God must complete his knowledge with prayer. Otherwise, as the Quran says, his knowledge would be like scattered motes, haba'an manthura. For knowledge is like a tree and prayer is its fruit. Inshallah, we'll get back to this image of the tree. Knowledge as the tree and the prayer is the fruit. The novelty lies in the tree because that is the origin. However, it is useful because of its fruit. Consequently, a servant of God must possess a share of each That is the reason Hassan al-Basri, may God have mercy upon him, said, seek knowledge without causing harm to your prayer, to your form, to your worship. It's not only prayer. And seek worship rather than prayer without causing harm to your knowledge. Since the servant of God must inevitably possess knowledge and action, it is more appropriate that he give priority to knowledge over action. For knowledge is the foundation of action. As the Prophet, peace upon him, said, knowledge is the guiding light and action is its follower. Now, this is not really a hadith. I've read it from the sayings of Mu'ad bin Jabal. And definitely, knowledge is the guide, knowledge is the imam. Action follows. Action always follow knowledge. And there is no doubt. So I would like to go back to the notion of the tree and the fruit. In the case of a pregnant woman who maybe she did not want to become pregnant, maybe she had already children and she became sick. Sick, her body became very weak. She has, heart problems, serious heart problems, and she becomes pregnant. And the physicians, 100%, they say, if she continues the pregnancy, she will die. Then the scholars would say that she is the origin. She is alive in actuality. And the fetus is alive in potentiality. And thus they might rule that abortion is a necessity in this case. I simply, something came to my mind while reading about the knowledge as being the origin. It's the foundation, it's the cornerstone, definitely. And the fruit is basically the worship. In fact, it's, if you have knowledge, it's a good fruit, inshallah. It's a wholesome fruit. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us knowledge and to grant us the fruits of this knowledge and to grant us the sincerity to seek knowledge for his sake and to act also for his sake. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.